Good afternoon. Please join me in welcoming Amie Stepanovich. Amie is the Executive Director at Silicon Flatirons, an interdisciplinary research center at the University of Colorado Law School. She is a nationally recognized expert in domestic surveillance, cybersecurity, and privacy law. Today, she'll be presenting her talk, Encryption Policy, From Past to Present and What Lies Ahead. Thanks, Amie.
Thanks so much, Matt. Hope everybody can hear me. I'm going to go ahead and turn on slides. Great. I'm so excited to be here virtually with you all for B-Sides Boulder. I moved to Colorado in 2019, which seems 20 lifetimes ago now. But it's been really a wonderful experience being here and getting to see the inaugural meeting of B-Sides Boulder, and I hope it becomes everything that I know it will be. So as Matt said, my name is Amie Stepanovich. I, before coming to Colorado, spent 9 years in public advocacy around tech law and policy. I was at the Electronic Privacy Information Center and then followed up working on international issues at Access Now. And I've been working on encryption policy since 2011. And I have to say, I don't think there's a single talk that I've given since 2011 where I haven't begged people to make it so I don't have to work on this issue anymore. Let's figure out a resolution to this. Because I think that this is one of the very, very few issues that everybody tends to agree on. So I came to Colorado, as I said, starting in July 2019, working at the Silicon Flatiron Center, which is the center at CU Law, focused on technology, law, entrepreneurship, and policy. And it's been such a great experience. And I've been able to bring some of the work that I did on encryption in DC here into Boulder, including working on the Encryption Compendium, which is now a resource that's available, featuring a lot of the resources that I'm going to talk about today. So I'm going to start with a little level setting. And sprinkled throughout the presentation, you're going to find a few photos, and some of them I'm going to explain, including this one. This is a screenshot of a Kindle of a book in this Expanse series, a science fiction novel taking place a long ways into the future. And I found it really fascinating that they're still talking about security flaws and data breaches in a book that supposedly takes place that far in the future. And I think one of the reasons is that encryption is really in an unsteady place. And we could still be, we could be laying the groundwork now for issues that are going to stay with us long into the future. And so the three terms that I want to introduce that you're all probably familiar with, but I want to talk about them in the way that policy folks tend to talk about them. One is the term strong encryption, which has a vastly different meaning depending on what side of the encryption fight that you're on. If you're fighting in favor of encryption, strong encryption is going to mean the strongest encryption you could possibly have in the in whatever technology you're utilizing. So what is the best way that you can secure the data within the constraints that you're working within? However, if you're one of the people that tends to think that having limits on encryption is, yeah, I can do that, is a good thing, then you are going to think of strong encryption perhaps as encryption that's good, but maybe not as good as it could be. Backdoors is another term that might be having, that you might have technical understanding of. Legally speaking, we like to use the term backdoor to mean any design changes made to facilitate access to data. So that could be exceptional access, it could be called lawful access. Using a term like backdoor in the policy space allows us to provide a term that the general public can understand and conceptualize encryption workarounds to mean. And the final term is the term warrant proof. And generally, the introduction of the term warrant will tend to lead to some ideas of the fact that law enforcement has an authority and ability to access information. But a warrant is a legal construct. What's given when you have demonstrated probable cause for a search or seizure? It provides a legal right, but not a practical certainty around access. So there have always been warrant proof searches that have been made available, whether the evidence was destroyed or made available through other means. The warrant has never provided an assurance that the search is going to be successful. So with those terms in mind, what are the arguments in favor of encryption? And they range, and many of you are going to be familiar with many of these, from limiting vulnerabilities and protecting individual security. Encryption could be a marketing mechanism, something that people use to say that their product is really good. It could be a way to differentiate themselves on an international marketplace or a response to international regulations. It can be used to increase the efficacy of a product, or for the protection, what I've always argued, of human rights and civil liberties for people around the world. On the other side, there are several arguments against encryption. Law enforcement says that encryption creates a zone of lawlessness. And what they mean is it increases their difficulty in investigating certain crimes when it's present, and it keeps them from accessing evidence that they're trying to get to. In addition to keeping them from accessing certain information, it can slow down investigations. And many of you might remember in the wake of the Apple v. FBI request on the iPhone, there was a statement that there might be a dormant cyber pathogen on this iPhone and that speed was necessary to break the encryption on the phone in order to get access to it as quickly as possible. This is, I think, an argument that didn't hold a lot of water and people generally didn't tend to agree with, but more outside of that specific piece, speed, it does can slow down investigations. In addition, it changes with the alternative methods of investigation available. Some of those methods can be quite costly, and so it can increase the cost of the investigation. It also can prevent access to some information that isn't available through those alternative methods. So with the basis of understanding, let's dive into the past of the encryption debates and where these debates have come from. So Aaron Burr, at this point, we've all seen Hamilton. It's on Disney Plus now. It's easy to get access to. He fought in the Revolutionary War. He was the third vice president of the United States. And he was also involved in the first legal battle on encryption. There wasn't a song about that, so you may not know. In 1805, shortly after he left the vice presidency, Burr traveled west and he formed partnerships with several individuals who were quite powerful at the time. The true story of what he was plotting is really unclear up till today. However, in 1807, on account of whatever he was doing, he ended up facing trial for treason under the orders of President Thomas Jefferson. He was eventually found not guilty. However, during trial, a letter was introduced as evidence that was written in a cipher, and another witness was meant to decipher and explain the letter. However, they did call upon Charles Willie, Burr's personal secretary, to authenticate that the letter was written by Burr himself. Basically, they asked him if he could understand the letter, because if Burr's personal secretary could understand the letter, then they could say that it was written by Burr. Instead, Charles Willie tried to claim his Fifth Amendment right to avoid self-incrimination. The court ultimately held that he did have to answer the question, and that merely by stating that he understood the letter wasn't going to violate his Fifth Amendment rights. But it did provide this strange little blip on the screen of encryption law that dates all the way back to the founding of the country. So we can fast forward quite a bit to the 1990s, and in fact to 1993, when the Clipper chip was introduced. The Clipper chip was a physical chip that was meant to be inserted into hardware based on what was presented as a powerful algorithm known as skipjack. Each chip would have a key. That key would be split into two, and each part would be stored in a different government database, either NIST or the Treasury. The Clipper chip was officially adopted by the government in February 1994. However, mere months later, in June, Matt Blaze would publish a paper showing critical vulnerabilities in the Clipper chip, which was supposed to be incredibly strong. And he almost single-handedly placed a big nail in the Clipper chip's coffin. But the government wasn't dismayed. They came up with a new proposal for a new system for key escrow. So they learned not to rely on a specific algorithm, but required that no key could be longer than 64 bits. And the keys would have to be held by registered government agents. They went through a lot of different proposals to try to make this key escrow system work. But at the time, because of the opposition around Clipper chip, there was pretty good organization and people were able to make really well-organized and effective arguments that the system was a failure and defeated and pushed back the government from being able to implement a key escrow system. Still, the government wasn't down, and they could instead rely on something that had been in place since the 1970s, more specifically, export controls. So starting in the 70s, all products using encryption were controlled under export control regulations, and they required a license to export them out of the country. This kind of existed quietly until the 1990s, when it became a source of contention in the middle of the Clipper chip and the key escrow fights. The government wanted to delay the expansion of encryption that they couldn't crack from reaching other countries. In effect, this created a series of quote unquote export grade encryption that was significantly weaker and could be used overseas, but it impacted international sales from companies and really hurt American business. The controls were challenged in court, including by the Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFF, who argued that code is speech and requires the same protections as speech. In answer to this mounting opposition, commercial encryption was removed from the munitions list in October 1996, and non-military encryption was removed from the U.S. munitions list over to the Department of Congress just the next month. However, it still required a license and would continue to require a license until September 1998, when several categories were removed. And it wasn't until 2000 that virtually all of the license requirements were removed for exporting encryption. So a lot of good victories in support of the development and use of encryption in the 1990s. And there was in fact one more major victory to triumph at this time. And that came in the form of the Communications Assistance for Law Enforcement Act, or CALEA, as it's generally called, which was passed in 1994. CALEA isn't generally seen as a good thing in the tech space. It forces telephone companies to redesign their network architectures to make it possible for law enforcement to wiretap telephone calls. CALEA was expanded in 2005, so it would include ISPs and voice over internet protocol. Excuse me. Discussions around CALEA generally considered the extent to which it was going to impact encryption. So they weren't sure how to deal with encryption when they wrote CLIA, and people were in disagreement how it would be written into the law. However, when CLIA passed, the terms of the law have specified and continue to specify that it does not apply to information services. So it was maintained to only apply to telephone companies, essentially, and that it couldn't be used to block encryption that was applied by a third party. So it protected the use of encryption so long as it wasn't implemented by the provider themselves. These protections and the fight back against the clipper chip and export controls are what have allowed encryption to grow and to develop into what we know today and to remain on the books despite all of these different efforts to edge those protections backward. After the 1990s, the conversation on encryption went relatively quiet for a while. In the early 2000s, there was a lot of arguing about government surveillance, about the USA Patriot Act, but very little talk on the ability to develop or use encryption. This would change in 2009 when the FBI started using the term going dark. The term was popularized in 2011 in testimony by then FBI General Counsel Valerie Caproni, who said, and this is a quote, "As the gap between authority and capability widens, the government is increasingly unable to collect valuable evidence in cases ranging from child exploitation and pornography to organized crime and drug trafficking to terrorism and espionage, evidence that a court has authorized the government to collect. This gap poses a growing threat to public safety." So that was Caproni saying that their systems were going dark and they needed to be able to find a way, basically past encryption, to preserve their evidence gathering capabilities. These efforts have kept up since then. Former FBI Director James Comey called for a serious conversation on encryption, and his calls have been maintained by Director Christopher Wray, Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein, and Attorneys General Jeff Sessions and William Barr, as well as other prominent officials, have all vocally supported backdoors to encryption. In 2016, these discussions were brought to national prominence, and what you all may remember was the case of Apple v. FBI, involving the phone of one of the attackers in the San Bernardino shootings. And the case was ultimately dismissed on the request of the FBI. So we didn't get an answer in court as to the effect, as to the ability of the FBI to force a company to undermine its own encryption mechanisms. But it really elevated the debates to this kind of fever pitch in the United States that has calmed a little bit since, but not significantly. In the wake of those arguments, Congress discussed several different approaches to encryption, and the House of Representatives even set up a working group and released a report. The report, which was the result of a year-long process of meeting with stakeholders and talking to people and having hearings, and it eventually found that encryption works in the national interest, and they encourage greater collaboration across different interests that are involved in using or dealing with encryption. Congress hasn't done anything else, and we're going to talk a little bit, or I'm going to talk about the current efforts in Congress right now. But since this working group, they haven't been able to, as with so many other things, come to any sort of agreement on a law that they could pass. So up until this year, things have been in play, but not getting the support that they needed to actually move forward. And finally, one word on NIST, the National Institute for Standards and Technology, and encryption standards. It was generally ignored by the broader public, but considered a huge violation of trust by the technical community when one of the Snowden documents provided evidence that, as was long expected, the NSA had worked to artificially undermine the standards, the encryption standards developed by NIST in order to preserve their own surveillance capabilities. The revelation prompted NIST to start a process to come up with principles around the development of encryption standards. That process went through several different periods of public comment. The NIST process went through several rounds of public comment. People fed into it, weighed in. There were a lot of meetings around it. And then in March 2016, the final version was published very quietly with little fanfare. However, it was a good thing because despite language that had been in the first two drafts of these standards, the final version removed a requirement to balance law enforcement and national security interest against the development of encryption standards. So it essentially allowed encryption standards to lay on their own without need to reference the needs of law enforcement in their development. Which brings us to today and what we're talking about right now. So I want to say a word on international efforts around encryption, because for a while the argument seemed to be placed on pause in the US while they picked up everywhere else. In 2016, the UK passed the Investigatory Powers Act, which allows the UK government to order the removal of any applied encryption in order to assist with the implementation of a warrant. There's not great transparency in UK law, so generally, I don't think anybody is sure how this has been used. Although in late 2018, there was a public proposal by two UK officials to implement a procedure known as a ghost, where they would compel communications channels to secretly add a government official into certain chats in order for them to observe what was being said. That proposal has been met with pretty broad international resistance. There's been a lot of discussion about how that would require huge technical changes for many companies. But again, with the lack of transparency, it's unknown to the extent that it's been implemented. Also in 2016, Brazil arrested a Facebook executive, which made international headlines. And the reason for the arrest was the failure of WhatsApp to turn over information in a case. The case was related to drug trafficking. The government had asked for certain information. However, because of the end-to-end encryption that WhatsApp utilizes, the company didn't actually have that information to turn over to the government. This was not deemed an acceptable response and ended up in the arrest of the executive. He was later released, but the contention between the Brazilian government and WhatsApp continues to this day. Excuse me. And then perhaps what I would say is the most egregious international example of legislation so far is the Australian Assistance and Access Law. It was broadly debated, but wasn't actually seriously pushed through Parliament until the late, late hours of 2018, hidden by the rush of the end of year holidays. It's a quite lengthy bill, but essentially it authorizes Australian authorities to order any modification to a service or device in order to further the investigation of any number of Australian laws. Importantly, Australia is also allowed to use this authority on behalf and with the request from a foreign nation. So not only is it able to be used to further Australian investigations, but other countries, including the United States, can go to Australia and ask them to use this law to ask a company to change its service on their behalf. Oh, that's another picture I will point out if you all can see it. In fighting for the assistance and access bill, then Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull said that the laws of Australia trumped the laws of mathematics. So I actually went to Australia and it turns out that laws of mathematics still worked. It was quite surprising to me at the time, as I'm sure all of you are shocked to know that they continued to work and that the laws of Australia couldn't actually change mathematics. So I promised that I would talk a bit about current legislation. There are two bills pending right now that could deal with encryption. The most widely discussed bill is the Earn It Act, currently being debated there are serious efforts to try to push this for a vote in Congress to get it to pass this year. Specifically, it gives government officials like William Barr the power to compel online service providers to break encryption, or if they don't, to be exposed to huge legal liability, basing their Section 230 liability protections on whether or not they would comply with those requests from government. The bill, it shows this evolution that we've seen internationally in approaches to encryption. Essentially, instead of coming up with a defined mechanism or way to undermine encryption, governments are instead saying, companies, you have to turn over this information. We won't tell you how, just nerd harder and do it so we can get the information. And in general, that prevents the same sort of concerted evidence-based pushback that was able to be done in regard to the key escrow and the clipper chip proposals, because we don't have a specific way the government is ordering that information to be turned over other than just a general requirement that it be. The other provision is the LAED bill, not LEED, LAID, or however you want to pronounce LAED. And I really can't describe this any better than this quote from Rihanna Pfefferkorn from Stanford, which is just perfectly a perfect summation of what this law would do. And this is her quote. The bill is an actual, overt, make no mistake, crystal clear ban on providers from offering end-to-end encryption and online services, from offering encrypted devices that cannot be unlocked for law enforcement, and indeed, from offering any encryption that does not build in a means of decrypting data for law enforcement. End quote. So it's kind of generally believed that the LAED bill was introduced to make the Earn It Act look more reasonable. I think generally we can consider both of them to be pretty ridiculous and requiring pretty broad pushback. And if you'll give me a minute, I'm going to end with some ideas for how that pushback can take place. So as you can see, government is continuing its efforts all the way through today. This quote is from June 2020 from Attorney General William Barr, who came back out and kind of laid an even finer line in the sand in order to push for Congress or for government to provide a means to undermine encryption. So there comes the question of where do we go from here? What comes next? And before we do that, let me revisit some of that history that I talked about, because I don't know if you can really try to figure out where to go next unless you figure out what was effective, what worked previously. And you can pull out some good ideas. So for example, in the export control debate, there were lots of different levers being pulled at the same time. Advocacy groups, including EPIC and the EFF, were pushing against pushing in Congress and in Washington, D.C. against these efforts. The business community was coming together to show that there could be giant losses. There had been giant losses from export controls, whereas without the export controls, they didn't really think that there was going to be any meaningful impact on national security. Lawyers were coming together. There were multiple lawsuits that were filed in order to show how the export controls were unconstitutional. In Karn v. State, they actually were dealing with Bruce Schneier's applied cryptography. Bernstein was an attempt to publish an algorithm in print and online. And there the Ninth Circuit actually ruled that code was speech and the regulations were not constitutional. Cryptographers came together. Ron Rivest explained that cryptography was going to get easier to implement and harder to regulate. A comprehensive report from the Cyberspace Policy Institute at George Washington from 1999 noted that over 500 foreign companies manufactured or distributed foreign cryptographic products in nearly 70 countries outside the US that weren't subject to the encryption controls. And in Congress, Goodlatte introduced the Security and Freedom Through Encryption Act with 258 House sponsors. It didn't end up passing, but it got huge support in Congress. And all of these different actors were able to come together. And as I said, in the 1990s, almost all of the encryption limitation requirements around export controls basically went away, or in, at least in 2000. Another example from the Clipper chip, where you see again all of these different disparate groups coming together toward a single goal. The advocacy community, the Computer Professionals for Social Responsibility, CPSR, organized an online petition with 50,000 signatures, which today doesn't sound like a lot, but was a significant number at the time when people weren't as used to signing online petitioners or online petitions. The business community, 26 computer companies opposed the Clipper chip outright and formed the Digital Privacy and Security Working Group. Again, cryptographers came out. As I explained, Matt Blaze was able to show how the Clipper chip was vulnerable and really put that final nail in the coffin. We had lawmakers coming together, and the international community even supported this. The OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, came out with encryption principles at the time that supported the development of strong encryption. One more recent example, the Apple v. FBI case had more amicus briefs than I believe had ever before been filed at that level of court. And in fact, my organization, Access Now and the Wicker Foundation, filed the very first brief in the case with the help of Marsha Hoffman, who's a wonderful lawyer who's actually in Colorado. And they told us when we filed it that they could call us an amici, but because we were the first one, but they only had space for one amici, which is a friend of the court, basically filing in support of one of the parties, Apple in this case. And instead of having every single different brief filed under that one slot, which they couldn't do, they ended up filing them all as defendants in the case. They just had to come up with a whole new way to file briefs because there were far too many of them and they never received that inundation before. Companies, technical experts, advocates, international lawyers all came out in support of Apple in this case. And why is that? What does giving up encryption actually mean? And I think this takes me back to that first slide with the expanse quote on it. There are so many consequences that we'll see across the board, and we'll see them longer into the future than I think we can possibly contemplate. Consequences for economic growth. The internet economy is largely based on digital security and encryption and needs it in order to stay secure and stay trusted by people who use it. From a law and policy perspective, who are you going to say no to when they order you as a company to implement a backdoor? Is it the US that can ask for one? Is it Saudi Arabia? Is it China? Is it Australia? How do you draw those lines for companies that do business everywhere? And then who gets to use it even within those companies? Local law enforcement, only certain national security individuals. There are fine lines about how these would work that present impossible choices for entities having to make the decisions. And security. Whatever the future holds, I would never have guessed that anything that happened this year was going to happen. Whatever happens in 2021, there will definitely only be more internet. And we have to decide where the money for security goes. And if we're going to continue to invest in securing that internet, or if only part of the money can go to making the internet more secure and part of it has to go to building backdoors. So the fights aren't going away. There's a lot at stake. And as you can see, interdisciplinary cooperation is absolutely critical. So I'm going to leave you with a quote from The Hunger Games of remember who the real enemy is. And I think that when we look at the future of the encryption debates, what we have to see is more cooperation or continued cooperation from the technical community, from the legal community. I say this as a lawyer. I know that lawyers can be horrible, but we want to work with you on these issues. The business community, it's really critical that we work toward the common goal to continue to beat these proposals back because they're on the horizon and they're being pushed through hard and they're not stopping. As you can see, these conversations have been going on for decades, and I don't think they're going away anytime soon. So that's it. Most people would end you with a photo of a cat. I don't own a cat, I own a dog. So you're getting a photo of a dog here at the end. And if anybody has questions and you got to hear me through the lag and you stuck with me, I appreciate it. And I'd really be happy to answer them now.
Excellent. Thanks, Amie. That was a great expansive overview of encryption policy, even with through the technical difficulties. And thanks for rolling with that as well. Let's see. So it looks like we have a question from Punk Coder. What is the most effective way that individuals can get involved with the fight for encryption?
100% call your representatives. I think people who haven't spoken to their member of Congress think that it's this futile exercise, and I understand why, because so many things that deal with DC politics are futile exercises. That dog is the most adorable thing in the entire world. But calling your member of Congress really matters. It is so important. They, especially when their own constituents are calling, they listen, and that influences what positions they're going to take and whether or not they see their position on certain legislation as being tenable, something they can sell back to the voters. Another thing is to support organizations who are working on this issue. If you aren't supporting the EFF or EPIC or Access Now or the Open Technology Institute, I know it's a pandemic and some people can't, and that's fine. The economy is hard right now, but if you have the means, these are organizations that are out there on the front line every day. And they'll keep you educated on what's going on. They often post updates when things are happening, and they could really use support.
Well, thank you. The next question is from UrbanSec. And the question is, other than destruction and encryption, are there other common forms of warrant-proof protection?
That's interesting. The big one has been the big one historically has been destruction, flushing things down the toilet, throwing them into the fireplace, Safes have been available, but it's a matter of if you can crack them, and there have always been people who can get through the security on safes generally. So you can see that as a potential way. You can't be compelled to turn over the combination of a safe under your right to self-incrimination. So if you do have a safe that just nobody could get through, that could be a way other than destruction, but it depends on how secure your device is.
Thanks. I think for now, the last question, unless we get any others, is from Spike. And the question is, how have the history of these encryption fights led to the problems we're seeing today with ransomware? Is there any way to balance the need to protect sensitive data versus the need to defend against malicious encryption?
I think these are really, the second part of that question, is there any way to balance the need to protect sensitive data with the need to defend? So there are a lot of questions that we should be having more serious conversations around, but we can't because we continually have to devote all of our resources to fighting back these proposals to undermine encryption. And so being able to actually dig into these more difficult, meaty problems, I think is something, as I started, every talk I give, I'm like, can we stop talking about this? Can we just like move on? Because questions around government hacking, questions around like, when should you be able to get access to this information? We haven't solved these. And in the meantime, a lot of this really troubling activity is going on. And I think I'd love to be able to spend more time on that. On the first part, the history of the encryption fights leading to problems. Yes, export controls, the limitations from export controls specifically led to some of the major vulnerabilities and incidents that we've seen over the last 5 or 6 years. The encryption standards piece from NSA and NIST that I talked about arguably had something to do with the vulnerability that came through with the Juniper networks a few years ago. So we do see the impacts happen over time. And it's another reason why you might not know the eventual outcome of what happens when you require security to be in any way undermined.
Thank you. So we have at least one more question from UrbanSec again. So obviously many parties have a lot to lose from backdooring strong encryption, in particular when the backdoor becomes widely known. So have companies who use DRM for copy protection taken a position on this issue?
I'm not sure. And I have to say, this is going to be an unpopular thing to say. I know it already. I've stayed out of a lot of the copyright debates because the world of people who get involved in the copyright debate, like there are toxic spaces in the tech law and policy space, and then there's copyright. And it gets intense really fast. So I haven't dealt with a lot of those companies. There is a direct interplay. I think Cory Doctorow has given some really good talks about the interplay between DRM and encryption and backdoors that I've really loved. And so I would actually refer people to his talks and presentations on this issue because I think they provide a much more comprehensive look at that space that I'm going to be able to give.
Cool, thanks. I think unless anyone has any last minute question or any follow-ups, I think that's it for Q&A. So thank you very much, Amie. That was an excellent talk.
Thank you.
I will try to get the slides from you so we can, in post-production, we'll try to fix it up.
Anything I can do to help. Once again, thank you for bearing with me. I'm so sorry, everybody. I appreciate you. I appreciate your patience.
No problem. Hopefully it wasn't too distracting for you presenting.
Not at all.